evening. We do begin with breaking news. The FBI confirming they're investigating this ongoing cyber issue impacting the city of Augusta. What they call unauthorized access has crippled many of the city's computer-related operations for the second time in a week. So now we're learning more about the full extent of this problem. Craig Allison breaks down what's working and what's not.
For Augusta Utilities, their payment systems are still working in person and online, and they won't shut off your utilities or hold fees against you. They just have no idea if you may have over or underpaid.
Well, the first thing that affected us the most is the inability for us to get into our billing software, which is all the detailed data on everybody's account and how much they owe and where they're at in the billing cycles.
For the tax commissioner's office, car tag renewal and vehicle registration is still up and working online, in person, and by kiosk. But they say you have to come in person to make payments on property, personal, or business taxes.
We were able to redeploy those at all three offices and continue to process. But because we don't have as many of those, we can't do it as quickly as we normally would. But we are still able to process.
For animal services, their system is almost completely shut down and are running things with manual paperwork. This means that Animal Control can take your call, but their 24 Pet Connect website is at a standstill.
There are many lost dogs that have come in that are not listed on the website. And because of that, we would recommend that anyone who's currently missing their dog or cat come down to the shelter to do a physical walkthrough and see if their pet is here.
Craig Allison reporting for us there. The probate office at the Judicial Center closed early at noon. This is the office that helps with services like marriage licenses, gun permits. While we haven't heard anything new from yesterday's announcement about the unauthorized access hitting the city system, we'll let you know just as soon as we find out more about that situation. To weather now, we'll give you a live agenda in just a few minutes. A wrongful death lawsuit filed for a woman who fell out of a patrol car after her arrest in Hancock County. The 28-year-old was arrested after deputies were called to her parents' home in Sparta. Her family called 911 because they say she was having a mental health crisis. Deputies put Greer in the back of their patrol car, but she was not wearing a seatbelt and she was handcuffed. The FBI says the rear passenger side door was never closed. Now, civil rights attorney Ben Crump says the deputies were grossly negligent and tried to change their stories.
They tried to say that Breonna Greer, this 120-pound young black woman, mother of twins, daughters, 4 years old at the time, they tried to say she has superhuman strength. Importantly, they tried to say she kicked open the police door. That's what they wanted us to believe. They wanted to just sweep it under the rug.
My baby, Breonna Greer, she wasn't no animal. She wasn't a bad person. She just had some problems that she couldn't control.
So the family is seeking $100 million in damages for that death, adding there should be a mandate that every police department send crisis interveners for mental health calls. The accused CrossFit gym owner, Scott Page, will stay behind bars for now. His bond denied yesterday after being charged with child molestation. Tonight, our Nick Veland has new details from those court documents.
Bond denied for Scott Page, owner of Bear CrossFit Gym in Martinez. Page was turned in by his wife on April 27th when a police report says that she caught him in the act with a 15-year-old. Page is accused of having a relationship with a minor dating back to December. Police documents say that he admitted to the relationship to his wife after she found Instagram messages between the two. Court documents show Instagram messages dating back to late December and January. They show Page sending hearts, love poems, and relationship quotes. One says, "Falling in love with someone you had no intentions on falling for is the most beautiful kind of love," and saying, quote, "so true. We spoke on the phone with the Grovetown Police Department, not about this case, but in broader terms when it comes to child molestation allegations."
Now, whether it's your high school football coach or something like that, I would look out for opportunities that a potential groomer might to isolate your child. So whether it's private sessions, you know, in a gym, or it's, well, we need to talk alone, or it could be, you know, it could start off as innocent as practice sessions in a backyard or in somebody's garage, you know.
Sergeant Loomer says it's okay to be overprotective when it comes to who your children are with.
It pays to be suspicious, and I'm not saying everybody has to take a polygraph to walk through your door, but, I mean, you know, just because you think you know somebody from work, you know, local park or church or something doesn't mean they need to be hanging out with your kids.
In Martinez, Nick Veland on your side.
As for that CrossFit business, it was empty today when we went by. The business next door telling us they're going to take over that space. It's been 10 days since a mass shooting in Augusta that left 2 dead and 4 others hurt. That night, a shift commander with the Augusta Fire Department actually ran over one of the bodies there on the scene. The incident report says that person was dragged more than 50 feet. Reports say the man responsible is the same one who had just pronounced him dead. And tonight, there's still a lot of questions about how this happened. Hallie Turner has been combing through the driver's personnel file. Hallie?
This isn't just something awful to hear about. Thousands of people have seen it. It happened in broad daylight and witnessed the streaming the chaotic scene live on Facebook. At the time, we didn't name the driver because the report said he didn't see the body. The sheriff called it an unfortunate accident. And tonight, after going through his personnel file, there appears to be no red flags.
This is a video that captured the moment it happened. It's also the moment that had us requesting the driver's personnel file. The firefighter behind the wheel said, according to reports, he did not see the body of the shooting victim. The vehicle's hood, he says, blocked his view. Again, we're not naming him, but he is a shift commander who spent 24 years of his life working with the Augusta Fire Department. In 1999, he was hired as a firefighter paramedic. He has 15 certifications ranging from paramedic to tactical emergency combat and casualty care. The case file revealed that officers get a quarterly checkup every 3 months. Each time, he either met or exceeded expectations. Comments on almost all of the checkup forms say he's a great asset to the fire department, good leader, and good co-worker. Documents show the only time he's ever had an accident in an emergency vehicle was back in 2004. Reports show he was newly assigned to this vehicle and thought he had placed it in drive, but it was in reverse. Damages totaled more than $1,400, but he took full responsibility and paid a small fee. Now, we did find a few marks against him, but they appear to be relatively minor and have nothing to do with his driving. For example, in 2019, he did not perform to acceptable work standards, but that had to do with a building inspection. And in 2020, he had an issue with a couple of co-workers and had some conflict resolution training. Again, nothing to do with driving. And at this time, he has not been charged in the accident.
In our newsroom tonight, Hallie, thanks so much. After 36 years of service to Aiken County, the council member there, Will Hightower, is resigning. Hightower says he and his family believe it's time to focus on overcoming some major health issues. In a statement, he says, quoting here, "I pray the council will continue to focus on constituent service." He goes on to say he still has plans to continue working on Nicholson Village, paving roads in his district, and the boxing gym. Hightower's tenure ends May 31st. A new fundraiser has dads sending in their best snapshots. We're going to take a look at these calendar contenders coming up here on News 12.
And as you're heading out the door this evening, we're still seeing some nice sunny skies, but temperatures are going to remain below average both tomorrow and Friday. And by the upcoming weekend, we could be talking about some rain and maybe even some heavier storms, especially along the coastline. We'll talk more about the holiday forecast coming up next.
Time and temp.
Anthony, thanks. In Lincoln County, a veteran-owned business is getting a lot of attention.
78 degrees on Monday, and then we're going to continue to warm things up as we go through a good majority of next week. 80s return starting on Tuesday.
Anthony, thanks. In Lincoln County, a veteran-owned business is getting a lot of attention for its latest charity venture. Back Paddle Brewing is launching a new calendar, and it's all about the dad bod. I will vote stop by to ask, what does it take to make the top 12?
Kyle McLeod's inbox is flooded with pictures like this.
Hundreds of shots.
He made a post asking people to send their best dad bod pics, and that's exactly what he got.
I recently read a book authored by the owner of the Savannah Bananas and how they're always doing wacky stuff. And our team put our heads together and said, what if we do a dad bod calendar?
McLeod says Backpedal Brewing likes trying new and different ideas. And he knows having a calendar full of shirtless dudes definitely would be different.
Usually, I think you're thinking calendars, nature photos, or swimsuit edition. We're spinning it on its head. We're getting a little bit of nature. We're getting a little bit of a different sort of swimsuit going on.
McLeod says a team of ladies will evaluate the pictures over wine to decide who makes the calendar. They'll have a lot to choose from, as hundreds of men are proudly showing off their bods.
I think it's great that fellow dad bods can get out there.
need a camera in the room as those ladies make that choice. By the way, you have until Monday, June 5th to enter. We have information on how to send in your picture on our website. McLeod says a portion of each calendar sale will go to a local nonprofit. So good cause there and a great idea. Three Westside basketball players signing those letters of intent today. Next in sports, Dan tells us why signing that dotted line makes one of these athletes think about her dad. And later, they defy the odds of the pandemic, and tonight, they walk across the stage. We're celebrating the class of 23. Coming up.
First, kind of like heroes.
Remember 3 years ago, COVID hit, forcing online graduation ceremonies and even drive-by and social distance graduations. So this class of high school graduates defied the odds, and they're walking across the stage tonight despite the challenges COVID brought. Alyssa Lyons, live for us at Evanstown Center Park in Columbia County for Harlem High School's graduation. Alyssa.
Richard, no matter where you were, you'll most likely never forget school shutting down and transitioning to online, only to be brought back into the classroom. Butler and Harlem students will never forget it. These students behind me that are about to walk across the stage will never forget it because they were there, and they're all the better for it now.
Honestly, at the end, I think it's all going to come out in tears. I think I'm going to cry. I'm definitely going to cry.
Seniors walk to the stage with a confidence they've spent 4 years building.
I didn't really actually start high school until like maybe my junior year because we got kicked out freshman year, and then we were like kind of in and out of high school my sophomore year.
And like walking is as simple as putting one foot in front of the other, their high school journey has been anything but.
Knowing that we wouldn't have that exact same 4 years that everyone else before us had, it was kind of sad to me. I wanted that full high school experience.
High school is already hard. Try adding COVID to the mix.
I honestly thought that we were going to have to do what the class of 2020 did, which was drive by and pick up our diplomas. But COVID taught me to be patient with myself and to be patient and to work way harder than I've been working.
They didn't brave the COVID wave alone. They had hundreds of teachers with them every step of the way.
Them having our back, it was really... It actually made high school a lot easier to get through, especially my teacher, Ms. Raker. She made high school for me, even though I was online for part of it. She made high school for me way more fun.
Today, they cross the string on the cap, looking back together. Now, more than 270 students will soon cross the stage behind me to get that coveted piece of paper. A little less expensive than the one that they'll get after college, but hey, you know, COVID aside, you know, I asked them 50 years down the line, what are they going to remember most? They said that region football championship and that state baseball championship just last Friday night.
Overcoming a lot of challenges, COVID included. Congrats to the class of 23, wherever you are tonight. Alyssa, thanks a lot.
On your sideline, sports brought to you by the Hawk Law Group.
Speaking of sports, they have the ability to bring a variety of different emotions out of us, whether it's the excitement of winning a state championship or the tears of joy brought forth by earning the opportunity to play at the next level. This afternoon, three Westside basketball players signed their letters of intent. Jalix Ewing is heading to Columbia to play for Benedict College. His close friend Zion Briggs will travel west on I-20 to Atlanta to play for Stats Preparatory Academy. Taylor Boddy signed her letter of intent today as well, and after suddenly losing her father a couple of years ago, she says signing the dotted line makes her think of the man who helped her start this journey.
10th grade, he passed away due to COVID, and that really affected me because I wanted him to watch me at this moment, to watch me sign, you know, to go on to the next level. But, you know, God had other plans, and it's all right, though, because everything I do it for him, you know. I do it for the family. Hopefully, I'm making him proud.
Next year, Taylor Boddy will be taking her talents on the court to East Georgia College. The accolades continue to roll in for the state champion Westminster boys soccer team. Sophomore Will Jeffords has been named the GIAA Class 3A Soccer Player of the Year. Jeffords led Westminster's offense with 20 goals this season. The Wildcats also have 5 players named to the All-State team, and a total of 6 players were named All-Region.
All right, thanks for that, Dan. Well, as you're heading out the door this evening, we're in store for some dry conditions, but the weekend, it's going to be looking a little bit more wet, and we're going to be talking about some cooler temperatures, only making it into the mid-60s for Saturday. We'll have another update on that weekend forecast when we come back.
That's the strong arm.
Call attorney John Foy and Associates today. We've got a lot of news coming up. Rock and roll music legend Tina Turner has died today at 83. Tonight we remember the chart-topping singer's career that spanned five decades. That and more news tonight on the CBS Evening News.
All right, as we go through this evening.